Let me welcome members to the second meeting in 2016 of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee and remind everyone, as usual, switch off mobile phones as they may affect the broadcasting system. Firstly, before moving to the formal agenda, as published, let me invite, I will be inviting Mike Russell to declare his relevant interest, but before doing so, you will note that Michael replaced Gil Patterson, and it would be entirely appropriate to thank Gil for his sterling work on the committee. We shall miss him, but we shall watch with interest how Michael replaces him. So let me formally welcome Michael to the committee and invite him to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, convener. It's a pleasure to be back on this committee after 16 years, almost, the last time I was on it. The only one I can think is even vaguely tangential is I have a part-time appointment as Professor of Scottish Culture and Governance in the University of Glasgow, in which role I do on occasions teach issues connected with the proceedings of the Parliament.
Thank you very much. Your expertise on governance is much welcomed to our deliberations. Moving to agenda item one. First item is for the committee to discuss whether to take items at 3 and 4 in private. Agenda item 3 is for members to consider a draft report and draft standing order rule changes on the admissibility of petitions and some minor rule changes. Do members agree to take item 3 in private? We are agreed. 3 will be in private. Now, agenda item 4 is for the committee to consider its work programme. Given recent interest in matters covered by the work programme paper, I'm minded to propose that we take this item in public. However, I'd like to suspend the meeting at the appropriate point for a short time before taking this item to the committee so that we can receive briefing from officials on the Sewell Convention and how it relates to our standing orders. And we do that in private before we begin the public discussion. Do members agree to take item 4 in public with a short suspension to receive briefings from officials in private? We are so agreed. Thank you very much. That's very helpful. We now move to agenda item 2, which is the Scottish Elections Dates Bill. Let me welcome Joe Fitzpatrick, the Minister for Parliamentary Business, to the meeting. We have no amendments to deal with, but standing orders require us to consider each section and schedule of the bill and the long title and agree to each formally. Before moving to the formal process, I'll invite Joe Fitzpatrick, the Minister, to very briefly just put on the record the purpose of the bill.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, as colleagues know, this is a very short and straightforward bill, but to recap for the record, it will move the Scottish Parliament elections currently scheduled for 7th of May 2020 to the 6th of May 2021, and it will move the local government elections scheduled for the 6th of May 2021 to the 5th of May 2022.
Thank you both for what you said and for the brevity with which you said it. We'll now take the sections in order and the long title last. Standing orders allow us to put a single question where groups of sections are to be considered consecutively, and unless members disagree, that is what I propose to do. Firstly, the question is that sections 1 to 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Secondly, the question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. That ends stage 2 consideration of the bill. Thank you, Minister, for your attendance. And we now move into private session. We will return to public session later. consideration of agenda item four, which is our work programme. I'm inviting the committee to consider correspondence from Mary Fee, MSP, asking the committee to consider a change to standing orders regarding LCM procedures. I'll just inform the committee of what we understand to be the timetable for the trade union bill, which is underlying the request from Mary Fee. We understand the bill starts its committee stage in the House of Lords on the 8th of February, and that that committee stage is expected to last until the 25th of February, although of course it could be longer. There then has to be a minimum gap of 14 days until the report stage, which is a further amending stage, which takes us to mid-March at the earliest. So that is just provided to committee members to indicate a time frame within which we might choose the way forward. I invite general comments from members on Mary Fee's letter. Well, perhaps I'll put something into the mix myself. Clearly, an amendment of this particular kind, in the way it is worded, could be seen to have the effect of removing a power that the presiding officer has to interpret the standing orders and placing it before Parliament, which in effect delivers that power to the government of the day. I think it's probably not what Mary Fee intends, and on that basis, I suspect that we should certainly be contemplating having a position paper brought to us for next week where we can check the wider implications of both the process that Mary Fee is asking us to undertake and the specific wording of her amendment. Michael.
Nobody is in any doubt that the trade union bill is a particularly obnoxious piece of legislation. Nobody is in any doubt that the Scottish Parliament opposes that. Nobody is in any doubt, as a result of this week's debate in the Scottish Parliament, that the majority opinion in the Parliament is against that. And there is also a view that perhaps the presiding officer is not infallible. I don't wish to commit lèse majesté, but there are different opinions about the eligibility of an LCM. What would be very dangerous, however, is to take a single instance of a disagreement with a ruling and convert that into what would be a rather, as you put it, interesting precedent, where there was a unique category of activity in this Parliament. Legislative consent motions have no particular, in fact, they have no legislative function in terms of binding the Westminster government, and convert those into a means of proceeding in which there was an basically political decision as to whether they were competent or not. That's not true of any other legislation, of other legislation of great importance. And I think that would be, at the very least, problematic in future years. So I think we should be very careful about this. I think that it's quite right that we look at options to move forward. But I think a single instance to create a new law, essentially on the basis of a single instance of disagreement with the presiding officer's ruling, is a worrying thing to do, and I think we should proceed with great caution. Also, in the last 6 weeks of a Parliament, to insist upon an urgent vote on a major change to standing orders, I think we would have to be very careful about that.
Patricia?
If I may, Convener, I would just like to correct one thing Mike Russell said. We're not proposing a change to the law. We're proposing a change to the standing orders of this Parliament. I think it's very important to remember that the letter which prompted our discussion today did come from my colleague Mary Fee, who's unable to be here today because of ill health. However, in effect, we have the greater will of Parliament now pushing us to take some action on this issue, because Parliament agreed to an amendment just this week that gave effect and specifically quoted the paragraph of Mary Fee's letter where she talks about a specific rule change. Now, I think we can perhaps make that even better than it is as currently drafted and proposed. But I would hope that in our considerations next week, that we have in our minds the fact that we are dealing with what is a completely and utterly bad bill. There's no other way to describe it. and that it is our duty to do everything that we can to protect people over whom we have the power to do so from the worst of its provisions. That is the intent of Mary's amendment. And I would hope that we would bear both that in mind, the will of Parliament in mind, and the fact that in order to be able to do that, we do have to have regard to the timetable that is in place for this bill, and we do have to act within that time frame. And that's not just my exhortation, if you like, to this committee. That's what Parliament said when it debated it this week.
Just for clarity, Parliament directed the words of Mary Fee's proposal to the political parties rather than this committee. I don't think that in any sense blocks us from consideration, just for clarity.
I would also though add that it also is the cross-party, as I understand it, with one exception, view of the Devolution for the Powers Committee, who have looked at this issue in some detail, that an LCM should be carried. And I think we have to give due weight to their opinion too.
The member's point is well made. David.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with the comments in relation to the trade union bill. It's an absolutely awful piece of legislation. Unfortunately, we don't have the power to prevent it from being implemented in this Parliament, much as we would like to and much as a huge majority in this Parliament would want to. But we need to be careful when we're looking at standing order changes that we deal with them in a proper way. And we have to make sure we don't allow politics to get in the way of procedures. So we need to look at these kind of issues where we're proposing standing order changes, take proper evidence, proper consultation, give it proper consideration. It's not something I think we should rush into. I think it would be setting a very dangerous precedent to do so. The Parliament has already expressed its view in opposition to the trade union bill, very, very clear indeed. And maybe that's something we all need to reflect on, the fact that we can actually do nothing about it.
Indeed. Patricia?
Just reflecting on my colleague Dave Thompson's comments there, I would just say that it is important that we get this right. That doesn't necessarily mean it has to take us a long time. And I would just say to my colleagues that it's also very important to ensure that we don't allow process to get in the way of doing the right thing.
Very briefly.
Well, that is precisely the point. Yes. There is a process which people are objecting to, which is the ruling, the effect of a ruling by the presiding officer. We're attempting to change that process to another process which would be unique in the Parliament, that it is a political majority that would decide the eligibility of a piece of a resolution coming in, not the view of the independent presiding officer. That is getting politics in the way of process in a way that will damage what is happening in this Parliament. So I think we have to be very, very cautious indeed. And I am equally as concerned as I was at the outset with the discussion that's been taking place. But we should consider options, certainly, urgently, but with caution.
Right. I think that's an adequate. People have put their positions on the record. Are we agreed? We'll invite the clerks to bring an options paper to us next week. Mm-hmm. Right. We are so agreed. Thank you. That's helpful. Now, just a couple of other things in relation to the work programme before we conclude this meeting. We have a letter from the DPLR committee on statutory instrument procedures. I'm going to invite comments from members, but given that I am on the DPLR committee and essentially I'm the person who persuaded them to write to this committee, it might be just useful if I just flesh out what has happened. Is that inadvertently the government laid an instrument using the negative procedure when the power they had only allowed them to lay it under the affirmative procedure. That laying appears in the business bulletin. In the light of it appearing thereafter that the bill, the order is legally incompetent, it is in law, it never existed. So therefore the legal position is clear and closed. But we are left with a situation that in parliamentary terms there has been no disposal of this particular instrument, which appears in our business bulletin, and nothing appears in our business bulletin to say that it's no longer before Parliament and that it will not come into power, into operation, as it would in normal course, after 40 days have elapsed. And I think this is a lacuna in our processes that we need to address. And that's the point that I sought to have the DPLR bring to our attention. I think the bottom line is, well, first of all, how do members feel about that issue?
I'm quite content with the recommendation that it goes into our forward work programme and we ask the clerk to consider possible procedures, because I've actually got quite a few questions on it, but I think I would need to have more of an understanding to ensure that my questions are sensible ones.
Yes. Can I say, as far as we're aware, it's the first time this has happened since 1999, so there may not be urgency. Michael?
It just occurred to me in reading it, one does get astonished that it can happen, but in reading it, that there might be a way in which a standard clause within such legislation is that if it was found subsequently to be laid under wrong procedure, it would automatically be revoked. That would actually deal with it. It's only one possible solution, so we'd better look at several solutions. But I don't think it's a matter that will cause us sleepless nights over the next few weeks.
The DPLR committee sought to persuade the government to formally revoke it, to bring a motion that
that's
nothing further be done. They argued that given that it did not in law exist in the first place, it was impossible to revoke.
I understand that, and what I'm suggesting is that that position might be added in words to subordinate legislation, which would then have the effect of revoking one that was laid under the wrong procedure.
Anyway, the proposal from Fiona essentially is that we should incorporate this issue into our work programme. Is that everyone's view, Patricia?
Yes, but I do think, well, I mean, I don't want to prejudge this in any way, but I would hope that the government was looking at ways in which it might find a way to affect a change, because it seems to me untidy at best to leave this lying in the current situation. And, you know, even if, I don't know if the business manager could stand up and say something in Parliament or, you know, just put something into the business bulletin, surely that would... explain what has happened
Can I say the DPLR has had a number of interchanges with the government making suggestions of that character without a positive response, which is why it has ended up before us.
Patricia's 100% correct on that. I think
The reason why I propose that it comes forward in our work programme with a detailed paper is that I've got, you know, we're beginning to get suggestions, but I would like to see a paper so that I can work out if my suggestions make sense.
But I think my point, though, Convener, is that while we might look at a process and might put that into our legacy paper as a recommendation for a future committee, there's nothing to stop the government doing something meanwhile. And I think it should, to be honest, just in the sense of making everything tidy.
Well, I can only report, it's not my duty directly to report from DPLR, but I think DPLR has had a number of exchanges with the law, with the government. They are sticking rigidly to the line that they have legally disposed of this. The issue for us is not, I think, the legal issue, because DPL accepted it's legally disposed of. It's whether in parliamentary terms it's been properly disposed of. Yeah. And I think DPLR is firmly of the view it has not been, and we need to address that issue. But DPLR is not recommending how that be done. And I think the point is that we should not make decisions on that matter on the hoof here and now. We just can't do that.
The point that Patricia raises is a significant one. I mean, I don't think it's out of incompetence for this committee to be able to say that that is a significant issue. I mean, if there is a statutory instrument floating about out there which has no validity or whatever, but some people might think, and it's also an area of some importance. You know, I think there's at least it might strengthen DPLR's hand to know that this committee believes the same.
As we're now having a conversation about it, can I raise one of my questions? Maybe the clerks can bring that back in the paper. It says that to DPLR, the committee, there's some confusion may still arise because stakeholders may read about the instrument in the Parliament's official report of its consideration. But surely the official report of the Parliament's consideration says this was laid under the incorrect procedure. Did DPLR not say that?
Yes.
Therefore, it's in the official report that it doesn't exist.
Yes, but if I may just lead you to a slight complication, that in essence the DPLR report records that the government have said that it's laid under the wrong procedure, under negative rather than affirmative. That has not actually been tested by parliamentary process as such. And so therefore it's a unilateral decision by the government that they've used the wrong procedure, which I think nobody's debating. But at the end of the day, you are left with the legal position almost certainly clear, but the parliamentary one, it remains open. Because it isn't in the gift of the DPLR committee it would only be for Parliament, not the DPLR committee, to take it off the business bulletin.
Presiding officer, I've done it again. Convener. maybe I'm seeing into the future, who knows. Convener, it's always struck me that the Minister for Parliamentary Business has a very interesting role, not least because he or she has a toe in both camps, the part yep. parliamentary and part obviously political and governmental. And it seems to me the kind of thing where a simple statement on the record by the Minister for Parliamentary Business would at least mean there was something read into the record that made the situation clear. And I don't even think it needs us to discuss that. It's happened once.
Can I say to you that proposition has already been put to the government and has been rejected. I also proposed in DPLR to the government that they simply lay a motion saying, noting the error had been made and that therefore, and they were not willing to do that.
An IPQ would do.
Yeah. Any mechanism.
Well, at the end of the day, DPLR kind of, I think the interchanges may have been the three or four interchanges without getting any resolution.
Could this exchange be drawn to the attention of the Minister for Parliamentary Business? Yeah.
We could do that if we thought that was...
I don't know whether it would tip anything.
Although I think it would be fair to say that the Minister of Parliament, this will not be news to the Minister of Parliament.
No, I'm sure.
But this, if this committee wishes, without closing the issue, to do that as their immediate step.
Yeah.
Okay, and we'll see where that takes us. Yes, that concludes today's meeting. Thank you very much for your support and assistance.
Thank you.